this. Father, thank you so much for your love for us and for bringing us to church today. You would never ask us to come here if there is not a blessing for us. And Lord, I come seeking for one too, and use my mouth and my brain to transmit the message that you have for us today, in my prayer, in Jesus' name. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, do you like fruits?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, my dear. You know, when I think about mangoes, I think about St. Elizabeth, Julie Mangoes. Yeah. Listen, I've been to Jamaica, man, and this lady gave me a Julie Mango grace. Lord have mercy. You ever eat a mango, and when the juice runs out, GMO fruits. When you have local fruits of me this year.
Yeah.
But fruits are just great, man. Fruits are just great. I like it. You know, on a hot day, instead of buying some kind of, what do you call them, this drink, this ting-ting?
Yeah.
You know that ting-ting?
Yeah.
It's a ting. Ting, yeah, it's a drinking ting, man. Buy yourself a mango, buy yourself a grapefruit. I need it, because fruits are beautiful. Yeah. Well, you can't ever think about fruits without thinking about trees. Hey, come on here. Because fruits grow on trees. I mean, I don't know if they start creating them in the crucibles in the labs yet. I don't know if they start doing that yet, but as far as I know, when I say check, fruits come from trees. So today we're going to talk a little. We'll be doing a little kind of a spiritual botany today. Okay? Spiritual botany, right? We're talking about trees. Are you ready for this?
Yeah.
Just one fruit, please. Just one. Ladies and gentlemen, look how beautiful it is, eh? You know, I remember when I was dating my wife. That's a long time ago, you know. I'm an old man, you had 5 grandchildren, right? And by the way, do you know we have our twin daughters? Our daughter is married to a boy with Kitisha and Yvisha blood? Yeah, our grandchildren have Kitisha and Yvisha blood in them. So I think I'm going to use that passover to get myself a passport, you know? You know, trees are beautiful. When we were dating, I remember going to, if you've been to Canada and seen cemeteries,
beautiful.
Oh man, serene, beautiful, flowers. You could take the girl and walk there and sit them in the grave. You know, hopefully no ducky, no ghost after you, right? But it's beautiful. Could you imagine what Eden was like?
Yes.
And by the way, if I, in my presentation today, you hear me say, put it on the screen, I got it from the He got baptized all over. Boy, put it. That's his line, eh? Ladies and gentlemen, and the Bible says in Genesis 2:8, what it said, and God, the Lord God, planted a Eastwood, and there he put the man whom he had formed. Could you imagine, ladies and gentlemen? Ladies, you like flowers, don't you? When she's vexed with me, I know how to knock her out. I just go and buy 12 long-stemmed red roses with one carnation, white carnation in the middle. Floor her, man. And I go right by her ear and say, well, that's you. Well, she's right here. Wow, my sunshine. You have to know how to do this. But ladies and gentlemen, the flowers and the trees were created by God for us.
Yeah.
And so people are going around destroying the ecosystem. Take notice, eh? Because the Bible says that God will destroy you for destroying his earth.
That's right.
But it's a beautiful thing. Look at the trees, man. Look at the flowers. God planted, that's where he wanted us to live.
Yes.
In beauty. Now when the Bible says, ladies and gentlemen, and out of the ground, God made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. A tree of life was also in the middle of the garden, and there was also another tree. What tree was that? The tree of the knowledge of good and evil.
Yeah.
Now please don't ask me about it. When I get to heaven, I'm going to No, I search your whole internet. And you know when you can't find something, you go to Dr. Google, right?
Yeah.
I met Dr. Google for a good picture. But you see, nobody was there to take a picture of a tree of knowledge of good and evil. So, hey, somebody had painted. Well, that's what I think it looked like. With the red serpent there. I don't believe. Ladies and gentlemen, in the midst of the garden, we kind of talk about Eden and trees and flowers. We're talking about the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. But the good news is that also in there was another tree. And again, we don't know what it looked like. That's an artist's conception. They figure out angels and all kind of stuff. And you know, in heaven, the Bible says that a tree is going to have a lot of different fruits every month.
Yeah.
So you mango lovers, make it there.
That's right.
And for you soursop lovers, be there. Because February will be yours, right? And I don't know how people like getting up and running out of the sea thing, you know? But if you like getting up, that's in March. Okay? So make sure you're there. So there was a tree of knowledge of good and evil also. Ladies and gentlemen, as we go into some spiritual parts of the year, let's see, what are the function of trees? Why do we have trees? Well, ladies and gentlemen, science tells us that the trees are what breathe out or give out carbon dioxide, oxygen, and take in our carbon dioxide. You see, we have some scholars here, right? They take in what we give out, and we take in what they give out. So, ladies and gentlemen, trees help in respiration for us to live. Clean our air. So, you see, it's important for you to take all this plastic plants you have in the house and put some real plants in there. You know, in God's church, we have no plastic plant.
Yeah.
You know, we just have some lazy people who don't want to water the plants. So they put plastic plants. Right? But plastic plants can do that. Okay? True process of photosynthesis, oxygen. And we take the oxygen in. And we give a carbon dioxide, and the trees use it. So, one of the functions of trees generated oxygen and clean our air. And next function, attracting rain. Huh? You find countries that have good rainforests always have an abundance of water, right? Yeah. I mean, you think about you have the mountain in the middle of there, like Amiga, maybe the heights of them. I'm getting there. I'm qualifying for my citizenship.
Yeah.
Okay. She's a teacher. All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, wherever there's a lot of trees and a rainforest, the land is fertile. So the trees attract rain. What about shelter? I remember that was not before. I remember going to the garden with my grandmother in Grenada. And when the rain started pouring down, she would cut a banana and leaf and would shelter on the time to push up, alright. You know? So sometimes the tree shelters from the rain. Ladies and gentlemen, then trees are good for relaxation.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. When a young fella, when mommy give me a trouble, but they don't want to see that girl, they take the girl and they go sit under the tree. Some of you thinking about it right now, but you did, right? The tree is a just relaxing place. Talk about the future, talk about the past, talk about our plans, right? Under the tree. Shade and relaxation. When it's hot out there, you look for a tree, don't you?
Yeah,
look for a tree. So trees are good for relaxation.
Yes.
Anybody remember when the classroom was too hot?
Yeah.
They took up our chairs. Yeah. We have put our chairs on our head. And we go under the mango tree somewhere. Yeah. There it is. So it's a meeting place or study for study and discussion. Trees. Great. God made them for us. Ladies and gentlemen, provide a number. Without trees, we can't build our houses. You see, originally God planned that a tree would be our shade. But after sin, remember what the Bible says, that there was no rain prior to sin? Because the Bible says that the earth was watered with a mist. There were no downpour. That water cycle thing did not exist. This evaporation and condensation did not exist. It was watered. But after sin, man had to, not only God had to find clothes for man, but man had to also make houses to live in. So we use trees to get lumber. What about shelter? checklist for birds and animals. You drive around, you see this birds making a nest and animals resting on the trees. What about medical values? Thank God for trees. Ladies and gentlemen, there is an astounding report. There's an astounding report on so-and-so. Did you hear that before?
Yes.
They made, and if we have anybody from the science community or medical community, please forgive me, but they've made this chemotherapy thing to kill us. Oh, yes. So much you know there. This chemotherapy thing is killing more good cells than bad cells.
That's right.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we found out, scientists have found out that soursop.
Yeah.
I didn't put it. Soursop is more powerful, more potent, 10,000 times more effective than strong chemotherapies.
Amen.
With all the nasty side effects and with the harming effects of healthy cells. So, Kitishan, start eating it before you get it.
Monkeys love it.
Right? Start eating. You don't hear a monkey with no cancer.
No.
Okay, they're eating your soursop. And you're chasing them with brooms while they're eating your soursop. Get it. All right, ladies, so medicinal value. All these are good functions of trees. Would you agree with me?
Yes.
Yeah, shade, building material, rest, relaxation, beauty, all these are good functions. But ladies and gentlemen, I think the best function of trees, primary purpose is
fruit bearing.
Yeah, fruit bearing. That's the primary purpose. God made it, and God said, Genesis 1, 20 and 30. Then God said, behold, I have given you every plant in seed that is on the surface of the earth, and every tree that has fruit yielding seeds, it shall be what? Food to you. And every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the sky, and to everything that moves on the earth, which has life, I have given every green plant for food. You think I'm talking about vegetarianism? You think, why is he preaching about vegetarianism? Vegetarianism? No, not at all. That's not what I'm preaching about. I'm preaching about giving one food, please. Ladies and gentlemen, Matthew 21, 7 to 20. Now we're going into it. Matthew 21, 7 to 20 says, and he left them and went out of the city into Bethany, and he lodged there. You see, ladies and gentlemen, the backdrop to this text is that Jesus had just finished his triumphant ride into Jerusalem.
Yes.
And the children were waving, and isn't it coincidental that they were waving palm branches? And where did these palm branches come from? A palm tree. And they were waving palm branches saying, Hosanna, Hosanna. And Jesus was riding a donkey in the hot sun, man, and he was tired, so he decided to go to Bethany. And now in the morning, so he slept that night in Bethany, and now in the morning, after returning to the city, he was hungry. When the King James said hungry, well, you left me hungry, right? And when he saw a fig tree in the way, he came to it and found nothing. Oh, Lord, that's going to be disappointing.
Yes.
You're hungry, and see a tree, and say, aha, there is food. And he walks up to it, but what did he see? What did he see? But leaves only. He saw in the distance a tree, perfectly foliaged, green, and verdant, and hope spring his heart, because he wasn't hungry. And she just walked up to the tree, ladies and gentlemen, and when he got there, looking for food, looking for a fig, he saw no fig. All he saw were leaves. And he said unto it, let no fruit grow on thee henceforward forever. And presently, the fig tree just said so and withered. And the disciples saw it, and their mother said, how soon is the fig tree withered away? I said to myself when I was growing up, Jesus is so in fear, you know? I mean, especially when they read the account in Mark. So let's go to Mark. But that's a tree there. A tree like that. Looks so green and healthy. You think you'll find a Julie mango there, right, Grace? And no mangoes. It's just goat food. leaves. So I went, leaves only. So I went, look at it. Jesus says, from no one no fruit shall grow. And the tree does still like a hydrate. So I went to Mark. And where another perspective came. Mark 11:12-14. And on the morrow, when they were come from Bethany, he was hungry.
Yes.
That's the same account from Mark's perspective. And seeing a fig tree afar off having leaves, he came. If haply he might find anything thereon. And when he came to it, he found nothing but leaves.
Aye.
For the time of things.